All right. Oh, somebody have some? You got it. Bill got it. All right. Shannon, you're up.
Okay. Thanks, Peter. Thanks, everyone. So just wanted to start today with a quick overview of progress. As Peter said, we've been continuing to work on edits and updates to the forest management plan draft. The draft is in one document. So you should have received a link to that, and we're continuing to work on that document. Part of that process has been continuing to review comments that we've gotten from the advisory committee, from this working group, as well as from members of the public. So we have a tracking spreadsheet where we're going line by line on those comments and looking at where they fit with the FMP draft, as well as consulting with researchers, both here at OSU and other institutions, and with ODFW and other stakeholders as appropriate on this next phase of the edits that we're doing, as well as responding to some of the comments that we've gotten. So we are working on sharing an updated version of that document by our deadline of November 8th, ahead of the next advisory committee meeting. In addition to that, we have also been working on the next phase of the stand level treatment allocations, which is partially what we'd like to talk about today. These are still draft allocations, so there are adjustments that that may continue to be made, including some operational adjustments that may need to be made as there is a closer look on the ground at what some of the operational considerations would be. But from what we're able to see with LIDAR and GIS, we've been incorporating what we can see into the reallocation process. One chapter or section in particular that we'd like to discuss today is the marbled murrelet experiment. That is a piece that was outlined in the research proposal. There's been a technical group with members of the advisory committee giving input to that over the past few months. But this is a new section that is being shared with the FMP working group. So that was one that we wanted to really focus on today. Any questions about just general updates? So to get started, we'd like to look at the stand level treatment reallocations first, and then shift to the marbled murrelet experiment and have a discussion there. And we had suggested starting with three sub-watersheds, 93, 107, and 119, because these are some of the more complex sub-watersheds in terms of needing to balance different considerations. And they are all triad E, but they all had different levels of adjustments made to them. So watershed 93 ended up having very little acreage changed in the treatment allocations from what we had previously to this current iteration, whereas 107 had a significant number of shifts just acreage-wise, everything still being balanced according to the triad experimental design. So that's why we wanted to start with those three. And then if there are any sub-watersheds that this group would like to make sure we discuss today, in addition to those, we can do that as well. I guess just for timing, and so we know, are there additional sub-watersheds that anyone would like to make sure we talk about today?
Okay.
Okay, and if anything comes up, we can look at that too. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen with the information that was shared ahead of this meeting. And this is using the same criteria that we discussed back in August at that FMP working group meeting that was applied to the initial 17 sub-watersheds that we looked at. An update for this version is that looking at steep slopes and headwalls. Part of this was looking at landslides. We at this stage have the preliminary landslide inventory that a couple of people had been working on. And so we were able to use that preliminary shapefile layer in looking at these subwatersheds as well. So these are the subwatersheds that are in this set of slides. And you can see here, similar to what was shared in August, there's an overview of which subwatersheds they are, the total number of acres that were changed by treatment allocation, and then the percentage of the subwatershed that was changed. So as I said, we'd like to focus today on one where very few adjustments were made, one where there were more significant acreage adjustments made, and then one sort of in the middle. And then coming out of this meeting today and the feedback that we received, we'll be working on combining what we've done on these subwatersheds into one document so that everything is all together. There also is a table here with the change in average slope and intensive by the subwatershed. So percent before and percent after. You can see the majority of these stay the same or decrease. There are a couple of areas where there might have been an increase in the average, subwatershed 10 in particular. And this is a subwatershed that is near Loon Lake. And in looking at the information that we have now with LIDAR, we consulted with a geotechnical expert. And I can actually just go to, why don't I just go to number 10 so we can look at it really very briefly.
And Shannon, while you do that, we just had somebody join by phone. It's a 503 number ending in 751. Can that person tell us who you are? You may have to do *6 to come off mute.
Hi, Peter. This is Molly.
Okay. Thanks, Molly. Gotcha.
Yep. No problem. Appreciate it.
Okay. So this is subwatershed 10. Just wanted to point this out very briefly, but this is one where we did have an increase in the average slope. And that was due to consulting with a geotechnical expert who was looking at the landslide history in this area. Loon Lake is down here. And there were areas here that had been previously harvested that are young stands, but in looking at the topography and the landslide layer that we now have, there was a suggestion to change this area that had been intensive, that's a young stand, into reserve, and take some of these other areas and put them into reserve as well. And so that required balancing and changing this area of extensive into intensive. So this is an area that that does have some steeper slopes than this area that had been an intensive. And so this is where mainly that change comes in. However, there was a concern here about continued harvesting in this area. And so that's why that was put into reserve.
So are you attempting to avoid those areas that you've identified as landslides?
We are, in this case, this was an area that that had been a slide, and I believe was pointed out to us as an area that, because of its location near a BLM campground and because of some considerations about how it might continue to slide in the future, that we take this area out of intensive and put it into reserve.
So that didn't answer my question. In general, are you trying to avoid harvest in landslide areas where there have been landslides?
Not directly. we are looking at the landslide area and we're looking at steep slopes and trying to, one of our criteria was to minimize intensive harvesting in areas of steep slopes where we can. There are, of course, steep slopes everywhere. So there are areas where there will be intensive and steep slopes. And so that landslide layer is just another data point, but we're not using that specifically to try to avoid harvest in that area. It's more keying in on, for planning purposes, when you would need to have a geotechnical expert come out and look at a stand in order to help with the operational planning. Did that answer your question?
No.
Sorry.
Maybe.
Can I jump in? I might be able to discuss this a bit. Just in general, even under the current forest practices rules, if there's a slope that's likely to fail and do harm or damage to human life and infrastructure, then you can't harvest it. And so when a geotech expert told us this has that potential, that's one of the reasons why it was swapped. And so I don't know if you noticed all that rubble at the bottom where it's gray, that's BLM land. That's the old failure that created Loon Lake. So this deep seated landslide has had a history of some pretty catastrophic failures. So that's one of the reasons. The other is in this experimental design, it wasn't that we took anything away from the intensive, we just put it into it. It's still the same number of acres. It was a swap. It wasn't a removal. Does that make sense? Okay, so the balance of the experimental design is still in there. And that's one of the beauties of the experimental design is we do have the ability to make decisions to avoid, you know, certain older stands, to avoid areas that are high risk, to go to areas that are more operational and more readily, available for potential intensive harvest. So it's that balancing is what we're doing here more than removing something from the base.
My concern is that we're avoiding asking the very questions that we need to ask. There are those of us that could argue back and forth about harvest and landslides, and that's mm-hmm. It's one of the questions that I would love to zero in on the Elliott is are they? And now I understand if there's a human risk, then yeah, you don't want to ask the question in that situation, but had it not been for the campground and human activity in that area, I worry that we're answering the question, and I've said this over and over and over again, we're answering mm-hmm. the question before we even ask it.
Yeah, and your question is, I mean, your concern is a good one. And I think that hopefully if you look through this list, you'll see a lot of steep ground that is still in intensive. So that's one
Elliott.
Thing. It's the one thing the Elliott gives us is a lot of opportunity to understand and study more about ways to really minimize risks. And like you say, in order to understand ways to minimize risk, we have to incur some risks. So I think we're still there. I don't think we've totally avoided risk.
Okay.
But we also want to be careful about human life. And actually that's just following the forest practices rules currently is, and it's not always the steepest slopes that are at risk too. That's the other thing. A lot has to do with the subsurface and some of these deep seated flows. But, and I think Deanne is on here and I think she probably would also have some potential input on this subject. But.
Yeah, I think in this case here, the two important points Katie brought up here in this particular instance, this is a deep seated landslide. And in that sense, it's much more similar to the Oso event. Was it Oso in Washington? Yeah. And of course, we have the proximity to human life and facilities here. It was, in many respects, it was a no-brainer. You just have to avoid these areas from a liability standpoint. It was pretty much the discussion. In other areas, I think the Elliott would be more characteristic of the shallow translational landslides that are an operational concern. And for the most part, those are continue to be a major component of the harvestable acres. That it's not in this particular case, there was a major concern. I don't think there would probably be any geotechnical expert that would suggest harvesting there. And it's an interesting point because there's not a strong connection that's been made between harvest and the occurrence of the triggering of these types of landslides, but still it's just a risk that you don't want to take.
Thanks, Ian. Let me go Bob, then Keith, and then Shannon, I'm going to circle back to you. It's helpful to get these clarity because it applies broadly, not just to the sub watershed, but we also want to make sure we have time for the three you wanted to focus in on. So Bob, then Keith.
Yeah, two questions for you. One is, but you're also bound by the new Forest Practice Act rules as well, right? So you do have those increased protections there for steep slopes. And I just want to make sure that I want to understand whether you're going to be guided by the new OFPA rules on steep slopes. And number two, when you swapped, I just want to understand, it was like for like, you didn't wind up taking older trees to protect areas that didn't have them, that kind of a thing.
Yes. So good question. Looking just to get back to this point that Deanne brought up earlier, this is part of a slide. You can see that it's relative. This is the 80% slope screen. And so you can see that this area is below that screen. Because it's part of that deep-seated landslide, but this is still an area that, for the reasons we've talked about, was identified as an area that should be in reserve. If we look at this from a different lens, you can see the before and the after. So this is the area of extensive here that was put into intensive to help balance both this change here and then up along the top of this ridge here that had been intensive, that's now in reserve. And this does not have the tallest trees on it. You can see a couple of little ones along the edge here, which would be retained, but this is that 200 foot tree height layer, the little red dots.
Okay, and is that visible from Loon Lake too? I mean, just kind of trying to get a sense of, because one of the issues there was just view shed.
Yeah, we would need to look at that probably with that that view from GIS. Deanne, I don't know if you've looked at that in detail from the Loon Lake perspective.
I haven't done an analysis of that. And I want to just point out too, the red dots are 150 foot screen.
Thank you.
All right, Keith.
And then there was a question on forest practices. I just want to make sure while you're approaching the new Forest Practice Act rules, which does have more protection for steep slopes.
Yes. Yep. Thank you for that that follow up. Yes, we're working with DSL through the HCP and with ODF on those details right now. So we've been in contact with both of them and are working on weaving that into the HCP and the forest management plan, understanding how the Forest Practices Act rules, the new proposed rules, would apply to the Elliott.
The Elliott's exempt, right?
Those questions are what we're working through right now with DSL and ODF, particularly related to the steep slopes.
No, the Elliott is exempt.
When that did we was exempt the Elliott?
What's that?
When did we exempt the Elliott? I thought OSU's position was always that it was going to be the baseline.
I don't think anybody's.
I'm not happy.
I'm just seeking clarity.
Yeah, and I don't think that there is reason yet for you to be unhappy or Bob, that we can provide the clarity you're seeking today. So, okay. I think clear recognition that this is an important topic, and I don't want to diminish the significance of it by jumping over it, but I also don't think we can answer it today. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on it without having the right folks and the right information for you.
Well, for one thing, the Forest Accord exempted half the stakeholders that we have on the Elliott. So if it's agreeing to those new forest practices, you've exempted half of the stakeholders that were involved in our process. And I don't think that that's right. And I'm talking about the tribes.
Yeah.
Tribal lands are exempted, not state lands.
You're all right. The confusion, I think, is coming about by when this process started with the Private Forest Land Accord and this question came up. I do recall being told, and I don't want to name who's told us this, but I do recall in meetings being told that because we had an HCP in place or in process, we would be exempt.
Correct.
And that was the words that were said at the time. But like many things, things change over time. So we've gone back to DSL and ODF for official clarification. And I believe they've been in contact with the Department of Justice to try to tease this out. So it's not like we can just give you an answer. I agree with you, Paul. I think you were probably in some of the same meetings and heard some of the same things I heard. But we can't move forward without having a confirmation legally and what's binding under the Forest Practices rules about that, if that caveat even still exists as this has moved forward or not. We just don't know. And I think, Bob, I think you were present in some of those meetings where that was said too. And so I just think it's like Peter said, this is going to take a little bit of time and getting some clarity and surety so we understand, and then understand how, if there are new private forest accord rules that we did have to adhere to, how they would affect this plan and how we would respond to that. That's another set of questions. So because we do have a very different approach here in terms of having something like 83% of the steep slopes in a protected category, how does that compare to a warehouser or somebody else who would also be held under that accord? So it's not really easy to sort this out, and it's going to take some time.
Thanks. Bill, it looked like you came up on this topic. Do you have something?
Yeah, just really actually kind of in alignment with what Katie just said. You know, basically our understanding is that there's a process for ODF to adopt the HCP and the forest management plan, and to basically say that, yeah, it complies with the Forest Practices Act. And so the forest management plan and management of the forest would not necessarily have to follow the FPA, but would be certified as being appropriate by ODF. And there's a couple different mechanisms for that. And we're kind of working through what those look like. And this was a meeting that we had just the end of September to talk about that.
Who's in that meeting, Bill?
It was Matt DeVore and Jeff and I, and Matt had been having some conversations with Jennifer Weekle at ODF, but it was just the three of us kind of talking about this issue and trying to figure out how to get that adoption of the forest management plan for the Elliott by ODF.
My recollection is there's clearly places in the working working documents that talk about meeting or exceeding the OFPA. In its most current form. There may be some places where it deviates, but I think where the default position is OFPA, it's OFPA. It's not make it up as you go.
Yeah, I recall early on Tom DeLuca saying that they would follow up the OFPA and any upgrades to the OFPA.
Yep, there's no question about that. That was pretty clear to us. Because we always talked about the fact that, you know, OFPA sucks and it wasn't, you know, it's a bad baseline, but that is the baseline on things. So, you know, it may be complicated because there may be some places where we are doing something different, but it shouldn't be below the OFPA.
Yeah, I think that's true. And I don't think ODF would accept an alternative plan that they felt was not adequate.
That who would accept it?
That they wouldn't.
Who this? The feds?
ODF.
Okay.
Hey, stay tuned, folks.
Yeah.
Stay tuned. Keith?
Katie, I just wanted to one bit of clarification. I'm understanding that the slope that you were just referring to is upslope from the campground, and that's why the change, and that makes sense. And so there may be people here who don't understand where the campground is in relation to that slope in the lake, and I thought you might point that out as well, which I think necessitates that change. And and as to Paul's comment about it's steep, it's the Elliott, that indeed is the case. I was up there yesterday, ran up Lakeside and over to the Millicoma and up Fish Creek or Kelly Creek and down Cougar Pass, and where you can find ground up there, that there's a lot of it that I was not that interested in finding a deer at the bottom of. So, and usually that is not the case. So, Katie, can you point that out, please?
Deanne, do you have that on GIS?
I'm sorry, I was tending to another matter here. Can you, what are you looking for on GIS?
The location of that BLM campground.
Oh yeah, well that shows on, if you've got that, it'd probably be easier just to bring that map back up, and I can point it out to you.
Yeah, that's what I was assuming, you could just point it out there. And there may be people who are just unfamiliar with that.
Okay, so you see the owl circle. It's right. You can see the lake, Loon Lake, and there's that 108 or that 80 acre section. I believe that's an 80 acre section there. The BLM campground is on the west bank of the river, and in that it's tucked in where all those boulders are. I've never been there, but it looks like a fascinating place to go spend some time if it doesn't make you nervous. So right where you're at there with your pointer, all those boulders, all that rubble, those are boulders, and the campground is tucked into those boulders. There's some infrastructure and facilities a little bit further up the hill, but that's primarily where the campground is.
Thanks, Dan. Okay. Any other questions on this one, or should we move on to Watershed 93?
Let's do it.
Let me go pull it up. Okay, so Subwatershed 93, Middle Elk Creek. This is a Triad E. It is a larger subwatershed. Stakeholder concerns identified are presence of marbled murrelet habitat, stream protection around Elk Creek. And so for this treatment allocation step, the main actions taken were exchanging areas of extensive in a northern spotted owl circle with areas of reserve on the eastern side of the subwatershed, which also helped to reduce fragmentation. So I can go ahead, let me pull them up side by side. So we can get a closer look. So you can see this is the owl circle here. These are the areas of extensive and intensive, as well as an extensive down here. So these were all made into reserve. And in order to balance the acreage in this Triad E, there's an area of reserve over here that was changed to extensive. as well as a small area up here that was changed from reserve to extensive. This was a difficult sub-watershed because of the presence of marbled murrelet habitat, as well as the spotted owl, and needing to maintain protections along Elk Creek, as well as for taller trees that are identified here that overlap with quite a bit of the reserve and marbled murrelet habitat. And so this was a smaller acreage change. And it is, according to the Triad E balance, about 20 acres high on the reserve. But this is where we left this one at this stage, focusing on balancing concerns about northern spotted owl and fragmentation.
So how many acres of older trees do you have at this point in there? Because one of the other concerns is just the, I think there were 213 acres of 140-year-old trees in that watershed that were slated for cutting. So it was hard to see how you're gonna not really hammer murrelets in that. And maybe this is a place where we do hammer murrelets as part of the 500, but this is a big murrelet watershed.
It is. So the marbled murrelet experiment is the 80% retention, starting with that 500 acres. And I know we're going to talk a little bit more about that experiment in the second part of this meeting. This could potentially be an area where that experiment could be carried out, or this could be an area that, if that experiment is carried out and the results indicate moving into the additional 900 acres that are outlined in the HCP, then this could be part of that second stage.
Yeah.
I'm trying to figure out, maybe it's not the place to do it, but it's concentrated in one watershed. So you have a lot of murrelet habitat. I mean, if you use it for the 500, I'm trying to figure out how with the layout of the experiment, as I understand it today, you could have it so concentrated in one watershed, I guess. Maybe that's something to figure out over time, but it seems like in order to break it up into smaller pieces for the experiment, it'd be hard to do it in this watershed with it all contiguous like that.
Yes, and I don't think the vision for the experiment is to have it all contained into one watershed, but that step of identifying where the potential stands are that could be part of that experiment, that is a later step. Anything else that this group would like to discuss about this example? Okay. The next one.
Oh, Shannon, one thing, yes, you might want to point out, just because there's black lines all over the place, that which one is the actual boundary of this subwatershed?
Okay. So this is the outline of the subwatershed that we're looking at right here. And you might be able to see it a little bit more clearly with all of the stand IDs for everything that changed. So you can see there was some defragmentation over here along the border of the subwatershed too. Okay. Slide 87. Okay, so next is subwatershed 107. This is another Triad E, 409 acres. Again, some stakeholder concerns here about marbled murrelet habitat, older trees in the subwatershed, and dispersed camping. The main actions taken here were increased protections on steep slopes. The average slope and intensive went from 70% in the prior allocation to 62% in this updated allocation. Also adjusted stand boundaries to increase operability, including dealing with some small slivers of treatments and adding those to adjacent treatments to decrease fragmentation. That was for extensive and reserve. And really the goal of reducing fragmentation while aiming to protect steep slopes and retain treatment acreage guidelines. And just a note here in this subwatershed that the RCA really, really dominates due to the Millicoma here and the 200-foot RCA buffers. And so you can see here all of the stands that were changed, and I'll show another view in a second that has them all highlighted. This slide also shows in yellow some roads. So this is responding to some feedback that we've gotten that it's a little bit difficult from this view to figure out exactly where you are. So Deanne added roads on one slide for each sub-watershed to help orient people to what they're looking at, but didn't include it on all of the slides because it does make it a little bit busier and then harder to see what else you're looking at. So this is the view that has the stands highlighted in aqua that were changed. And I'll show the side-by-side in a minute, but you can see the marbled murrelet habitat here across the sub-watershed, lots of bends in the river. And so this was something that we kept an eye on in looking at these allocations and making sure that there are protections, particularly along steeper slopes along the river. And here's a view of where those steep slopes are. So again, this is an 80% screen. So if we look at them side by side here, and again, if we come back to this slide, we can see the outline a little bit easier of the sub-watershed in black. So you can see an area of here in the edge of the spotted owl circle that had been an intensive, it's now reserve and extensive. You can see along here, along the Millicoma River, an area that was put into reserve from extensive, balanced out in part by moving some areas that were over here in reserve into extensive. And another area here that had been some smaller stands of extensive that are right along the Millicoma and also in marbled murrelet and tall trees that were moved into reserve. So there's areas of that had been reserve in marbled murrelet that became extensive and vice versa. Deanne or Katie, is there anything else you want to add on this one?
Well, nothing for me.
Well, I'll go ahead and jump in just to point out, you know, we were looking at steep slopes and one of the issues was, if you notice, because of because of the way the Millicoma is, the sinuosity of the Millicoma is it's bending, some of these areas along the outside of the bends are areas that are potentially actively eroding. You know, it's just a morphological process. And so the initial allocation was based strictly on age, and we didn't consider that. And so in this, we did consider, you know, the fundamental processes that are occurring along the river and placed those areas that would potentially erode straight directly down into the river, those hill slopes into reserve. So that was one of the primary considerations. Not just from the sense of steep slope per se, but because of the proximity to the Millicoma and the processes that are occurring there.
Yeah, thanks for clarifying that, Deanne. So you can see one of those areas up here and another down here.
So Shannon, I guess, What's the concern on this watershed from an environmental standpoint was you had a very big intact stand of marbled murrelet habitat and it was getting fragmented. In fact, one of the recommendations that we made was that it should be in a different category because of that, because it's almost impossible not to, the way it's in this category, not to really just fragment that to pretty much, you know, it's going to get that stand very hard the way it's designed. And so I'm curious whether you see a net gain or loss under this scenario for Marble Marlettes at the end of the day.
Yes, so we do have that comment. And at this stage, based on the research proposal, this is a triad E. And so those are the constraints that we're working within and looking at the allocations. Dan, I don't know if you have an acreage on marbled murrelet habitat. If not, we can follow up with you on that, Bob. But a main area to look at would be, you know, over here, that was put into extensive, that is in marbled murrelet habitat. There are some areas that were extensive that were changed to reserve. Again, this is an area that would be subject to harvest either as part of the marbled murrelet experiment or only after that 500 acre marbled murrelet experiment took place.
Do you have a map there that just shows me marbled murrelets, marbled murrelet habitat that is slated for cutting? I'm just trying to get a, with all the colors, it gets to be a blur on the screen here.
Sure. I can zoom in on this one.
All right.
So you can see this is the sub-watershed outline right here.
Okay.
The crosshatch is all marbled murrelet. And then the red dots are the 150 foot tall trees. So you can see quite a bit here in marbled murrelet and extensive, and some smaller areas, because this is a triad E, in reserve and marbled murrelet. There's also an area here where you can see the modeled and occupied data that we have right now, which is an old data set, and we've talked about this before, is showing marbled murrelet habitat and intensive. The Betts Lab is currently working on updating that model with the new LIDAR data and forest inventory data that we have.
Bob, is your question, is there more acres that are being harvested than was agreed to in the December, whatever, 20, or April, I guess, 2020 version? Is that your question?
Yeah, well, that's the question, is whether you're able to ameliorate that at all. And the comment in the 2020 discussion was, this is one of the wet watersheds we flagged as, you know, having a huge amount of intact marbled murrelet habitat that's just getting, as I said, pretty hammered. And was there a way to think about that differently? Because
I think hammered is a strong word, but that we can have another discussion on that. But I think your question though is, did we increase the acres relative to what was agreed to in December? And I kind of don't think so, but we haven't actually done the calculation, but we're happy to do it. But we pretty much swapped again between, we would have swapped between reserve and extensive and not reserve and intensive. So I don't think we would have changed the number of acres that had either full or the protection offered by extensive. So I think those are that's your question. And I think we can answer that question
pretty well. And I think part of it is also being driven by the information we're getting in the extensive discussion, which is showing that a lot of that's probably going to be clumping rather than thinning kind of an approach, which basically there's no question that with clumping, you're going to lose potentially a lot of marbled murrelet habitat. If you're going kind of with a light touch of 20%, then maybe not if it's thinning, but if you're talking about just, you know, clear cutting and then leaving clumps, then you're talking about losing that habitat. So it's being informed by a variety of different things. But yeah, we'd love to know One is the age constitution of the cutting increased, and two, has the amount of marble merlet habitat in that area increased as well?
Yep.
And we'll hear our comments to reduce that, not to increase it.
Yeah, you can also see on this fact, this, I don't know, graphic, it really shows it, is how much of younger stands, and that one big kind of dark green or fairly dark green triangle is really illustrative of a huge chunk of it, what's intensive young forest being in marble murrelet habitat. And so that's the other thing we're struggling with a lot is you know, in both cases, that was called marble murrelet habitat. We don't know why. There's a little bit of old trees, look like as part of an old riparian buffer. But as far as that truly being marble murrelet habitat, I think that's a huge question. So we also have a process that was identified in the last draft of the proposal that everyone agreed to say, you know, we need to take a look at these and truly identify where the marble murrelet habitat is. And it, by just blanketing it marble murrelet habitat now, doesn't necessarily mean it's correct. And so understand, that's why we have that process in place, is to be able to do that when we have some more time. But I think that's also part of this whole conversation about the trying to defragment things, keep the continuity of the habitat, and to improve the habitat with time. And that's the experiment. That's what we're trying to test. And so I don't think in this case we changed any net acres, but in order to do more protection of the riparian system, and maybe we took a 140-year-old stand and replaced it with a 135-year-old stand, or, you know, so there may be some slight age changes, but that's a possibility. But I don't think there's any change in the total acres relative to what we agreed to in December, but we'll confirm that.
Yeah, I want to dig down. I mean, I guess what I want to understand was where these changes are. Have we increased or decreased the integrity of marble murrelet habitat? You know, so I think that's what we're really after at the end of the day, is whether it's got more integrity or less integrity in terms of its viability.
Yeah, well, there's a spatial and temporal question to that, and that's what we're looking at. So, yep.
Thanks, Katie. Keith?
Yeah, I'll state the obvious here, and I don't think Paul Odenthal's here, but I know this is underlying everything, Katie and Shannon. I know that the message is there, but remind us now and again that all of the changes we do, or that you guys do, that you're still developing a program that pays for itself in terms of harvest, because this doesn't work very long if that isn't the case. So I'd appreciate hearing that. I know it's there. I know it's on your mind. I know it is part and parcel of what we've been trying to do, but it's also not a bad thing to hear that on a regular basis. It would make me comfortable, and I think there would be others as well. I won't mention Paul. So thanks.
Yes, that's a really good question. That's something that we're continuing with all of these updates to work on modeling. And so we've been going through this process with DSL through the course of the summer and into the early fall of a financial review based on the information that we have now. So we're working on those discussions, and we still have this next step that's been planned of using these updated treatment allocations as well as the new forest inventory data and recommendations that are coming out of this financial review process to update the modeling that's being done and look at the range of values of what we might be able to expect. So that alongside of this work, that process is also continuing. And some of the criteria that are going into the stand level treatment allocations here, we are still working to keep the intensive, extensive, and reserve balanced according to the triad design. And one of the criteria was silvicultural priority. So that involves taking another lens beyond the first cut that was just stand age and looking at operability and how we might think about going into these stands. And that's caused some adjustments too between intensive, extensive, and reserve, still keeping with those commitments that are at the beginning of this slide deck. And so that plays into these questions about the financial sustainability and the modeling as well.
Okay, thank you. I didn't mean to hijack it. I know it's linked and that makes it more complicated than we have time for, but I appreciate your explanation. But I'm sure you appreciate all of our concerns in that regard too. Thanks.
Thanks, Keith. And no need to apologize for the reminder there. I think it's certainly on and a facet that's on everybody's mind. Paul?
Yeah, you beat me to it, Keith. Just because it's Monday and I'm slow and the map, as Bob described, kind of just gets to be a blur with all the different colors. If you go to the middle of this slide where the oxbow, the big, you know, almost completely cuts off on that little peninsula right there in the middle. Could you just, right where you have the cursor, could you explain what is going to happen right there? And then further on out the peninsula, if anything?
So this area right here?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is an area that had been in extensive, just purely based on stand age. But then as Deanne was describing, looking at the sinuosity of the river here, can go back, sorry for the back and forth. Looking at how these areas interact with topography, this for operational reasons was changed from an extensive to a reserve.
Okay.
And so this is an area that, and you can see the in gray here, the buffer, the RCA buffer on the river too. And so there is the restoration thinning experiment in stands that are less than 65. I don't have the age of this stand right here, but this had been an extensive. So Deanne, I'm not sure if you have that pulled up, but that's where the restoration thinning experiment is concentrated, and that's in the RCAs here. There is continued discussion about whether there could be restoration treatments in the MRW reserve or just in the CRW reserve, but this area is marbled murrelet and reserve. So, and looking at just the configuration of the river here, that would all weigh into what would happen here. And so really this is reserve.
As it should be, it's inoperable.
Yeah.
I don't know, you can't get there from here. Maybe you could yard it from the other side of the river, but.
And that's why this was changed.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
All right, Shannon, let's move to the next one.
Okay, the last one that we wanted to make sure to look at was 119. This is another Triad E, Solander Creek. Again, an area where there's been a lot of discussion with stakeholders and concerns about marbled murrelet and northern spotted owl. The goals here were increasing protections for streams, steep slopes, and the northern spotted owl circle. And so the areas that were focused on were changing areas of extensive to reserve. Sorry, there's a punctuation error there. And particularly around the edge of the owl circle, steep slopes and the confluence of the streams. So let's go to this view so we can see it a little bit better. This is an area that about 30% of the sub-watershed acreage was adjusted for this step. in the treatment allocation just based on those other criteria. And you can see here's the outline of that sub watershed in black, just to orient everyone. And so you can see northern spotted owl circle almost entirely contained within the sub watershed, as well as quite a bit of marbled murrelet habitat. Again, this is a triad E, so we're working under the constraints of that percentage allocation as well. You can also see some areas here with some steeper slopes that were taken into account too. So there's quite a bit here that's in extensive, some in intensive, and some of these were changed. So this area here, as well as here and up here, which are part of the owl circle. So if we look at this side by side, what we're seeing, and again, this is that area of steeper slopes. So this had been in extensive, now it's in reserve, and it's in marbled murrelet and in northern spotted owl circle. This area up here, to partially balance of that, was in reserve. Now it's extensive. This is an area that wasn't as steep. There's an area here that was changed from intensive to extensive. A small acre area here that's got some tall trees and is very steep that was put into reserve. And some areas here that had been in intensive in the northern spotted owl circle that were shifted to extensive. And then down here, in order to balance out those acres, this area was changed from extensive to intensive.
How low does that stand down there?
This one right here. Dan, yeah. Do you have this pulled up in GIS?
I do. It'd take a shift, but just looking at that, I'm guessing it's about 40 years old. It's just the underlying layer is the age layer, or is the tree height layer, and there's no tree heights there that would indicate that that is a native stand, that's a prior harvest stand. If you like, give me a minute. I'll go look up the age.
Okay.
I'm guessing, and this is around 40.
Okay. And this is also, if you look at the color, darker is younger.
Again, the same questions come in given the experiment and how much land looks like it's in marble murrelet, occupied marble murrelet habitat. You've got a lot of land and extensive in this one. That'll fragment a pretty good block of marble murrelet habitat. And again, I wonder just how that's going to lay out with the experimental design on marble murrelets, where you have a huge amount of it concentrated in one watershed.
Yes, so as Katie said, we'll run those numbers now that we've done this treatment allocation. Looking at this sub-watershed in particular, you can see some areas that, again, darker is younger, and we can pull up the age of these stands here too. But this is an area that, based purely on the stand age screen, so less than 65 years as of 2020, that had been an intensive. It's also been identified as marbled murrelet, but so this is something that would probably be addressed with the model update, but is also in extensive right now. There's also this area here that has quite a bit of tall trees as well as marbled murrelet habitat. And this area was moved from extensive to reserve, balanced out by a small area over here. There's also mamu that went from reserve to extensive. So there are trade-offs here.
Yeah, I guess I'm looking around 10 o'clock and I'm looking around 5 o'clock. There's kind of a band of extensive that cuts really from 10 o'clock at night from 10 to 5, I guess, that goes all the way through the watershed, except for that little gap in the middle that's blue. Just looks like a lot of, you know, it's pretty massive chunk of murrelet habitat. So again, if you're using clumping and you're focusing a lot of your, I think what I'm trying to get at is our expectation was there was going to be a pretty light touch on marble murrelet habitat. And if you're going in and actually clear cutting and using clumping across an area that big, it's really not a light touch. Even if it's only 20%, you're really going in and just fragmenting the heck out of a really big block. So if it was thinning, I would have less concern. Where it gets to be clumping with clear cutting around it, suddenly, you know, I think you really are making a huge chunk of habitat probably non-viable. And maybe you're going to concentrate all of your work in one place, but that's not what I see from the research design. So I guess I'm just trying to figure that out.
Yeah, from my understanding, talking with the extensive group, which I know you've been in some of those conversations too, in order to do an 80% retention, what you're looking at are small patches in order to make that work. And so that's something that the extensive group and the marbled murrelet group are working through right now. These areas that you're mentioning, Bob, again, would either be part of that 500 acre experiment or looking at this configuration right here, you know, maybe more likely come after that experiment.
Right. Yeah. And I won't blow it anymore, but I mean, we're talking about regen harvests in marble murrelet habitat is the issue here.
Well, we have talked about regeneration harvest in marble murrelet habitat for 4 years, and we have them in the plans, and you keep calling them clear cuts, and that, you know, that can be left to a continuum of a definition of a clear cut. Is a 1 acre patch cut a clear cut? Is, but those have always been part of it. We've talked about 20 to 8, or in this case, 80% retention in the initial harvest. So we're not talking about anything differently than we were talking about last April. And I don't know where the disconnect is, Bob, but we're not changing anything. Those have always been part of the discussions, and that
they've been part, as have thinning and other strategies as well.
Well, thinning is a term that's not used in a regeneration cut. It's a selective harvest in a regeneration cut. A thinning is a pre-treatment, or it's a treatment of a cohort that needs to have a density reduction that's not related to a final harvest. Like, you don't try to obtain regeneration in a thinning. When you do a regeneration harvest, you're trying to obtain regeneration. And you need to create conditions where you're going to get regeneration to be successful. And that's the main difference there. But it doesn't necessarily
mean... I understand the difference, but it's an emphasis that is more impactful on this. And there's different ways to go.
Yeah, so. But it's no different than what we talked about. And you're right. You could do an individual tree harvest, which is kind of what you're calling a thinning, I think. But if the individual tree harvest... you might need to group 3 or 4 trees together to get a big enough gap to get regeneration, just depending on the conditions of the stand. And so so it's not necessarily clear cuts, but it's just, again, there's a continuum. We're not going to be out there with, you know, 20 acre clear cuts in the extensive treatment.
Let me go to Paul real quick. You've been patient there, Paul.
I just kind of an observation that I've had from being out on the Elliott and listening to the back and forth for a couple of decades now about what we're doing. The Elliott's pretty fragmented. It's been heavily managed. And looking at these maps, the thing that strikes me again is how much habitat is out there. Owl habitat, murrelet habitat, and I think that's something that we need to think about. This fragmented forest that supposedly we've destroyed has got all this incredible habitat out there. And I still believe, especially with the murrelets, that we have created murrelet habitat by opening up those stands and creating those trees that they like to nest in. So, the other thing that I want to say is what we're trying to do is find ways that we can harvest and improve habitat. That's what this to me is about. It isn't about
reserves and the status quo. It's about doing active management that actually benefits the habitat and actually benefits the economy, that people that will take what we learn here and apply it to their lands. That's what we want to do. That's the goal. And if we do nothing but thinning, where we open up these stands, we actually destroy the future value of those trees, because they become open grown. They grow big limbs. They don't have the quality that they need for manufacturing lumber. Got to do some of that, but the clumping still keeps those limbs small, and it's a good thing, but it's a trade-off. And I understand what you're saying, Bob, but I think we need to look at the trade-offs.
Thanks, Paul. Yeah. Some of the things that are most interesting to you and exciting to you are the things that, you know, make Bob and his cohort most nervous, and that's maybe not a surprise, and that's okay. And there are others that, you know, are more closely aligned. So I appreciate you flagging it. It's important to hear it. Shannon? And Bob, I see that you have to leave, and we also lost Mark as well. So I just wanted to flag that.
Okay. So if there aren't any other sub-watersheds or any other questions that this group wants to go through on the draft reallocations that were sent out, we'd also like to talk about the marbled murrelet experiment in more detail. So we can move on to that, unless there's any other discussion points.
Shannon, aren't you pleased that we're such a well-behaved class and we just go right where the teacher takes us every day?
Peter might be. okay, well, I am going to pull up a PowerPoint slide and turn it over to Jen to walk us through an overview of what was shared on the marbled murrelet experiment.
Thanks, Shannon. You can go to the next slide here. So I'm not going to get into murrelet biology too much here. On this slide, I just want to tag that for the purposes of this presentation, I want to highlight that there has been a long-term study of murrelet breeding going on in Oregon that's currently wrapped up. That's the Oregon Marble Murrelet Project. And they are, if you click one, Shannon, I think it'll pop up. There we go. And they're currently wrapping up a study that's actually going to be informing some of the work and the research going on in the Elliott, but also specifically to this murrelet experiment. So we have an old figure of up to 18,000 acres of occupied murrelet breeding habitat, as Shannon alluded to. This is under review right now. Matt Betz's lab is going back and rerunning some of those models with the new 2020 LIDAR data. So that's happening right now. Or sorry, that says 2022, but I think it's 2020 LIDAR data. So that's currently being added to the species distribution model. So we should have a better handle on what that actual figure is. So if you read through the text of the experiment that we sent out, there's just an X in place of the acres, and that's because of that ongoing analysis. The purpose is,
Sorry, Jen, just to clarify, so the current, or what was used for the research proposal in the HCP, that data layer for marbled murrelet habitat is both the occupied habitat from ODF and Kim Nelson's data and modeled habitat. So it's the modeled portion that is being updated, not the ODF occupied layer.
Although I think I talked to, just to add, I think that they were going to review the historic data as well and make sure that was still in murrelet habitat. But yeah.
How much is actually occupied and not not modeled? I mean, 18,000 acres, that's a bunch. That's a lot of murrelets for something that there's not supposed to be very many of. How many murrelets are out there?
So I'm not sure what the current Oregon figure is, but as far as, so there's a couple of ways that they're finding what the occupied habitat is. The question is whether they've been looked for on the Elliott. So some surveys have happened pre-harvest, and those include two consecutive years of going out and surveying for murrelet habitat or for murrelets. But there's a lot of questions in that survey now, A, whether they're even being detected in those surveys, and B, even if they are detected, their detections, if they have a below canopy flight, so basically below the highest levels of the trees, or there's some circling behavior that habitat is classified as occupied. So the murrelets can have a wide swath of land that's occupied, whether they're actually nesting in that. This is all still under discussion and review right now. So these surveys detect that the murrelets are present. The question is still, are they actually nesting in that stand? And so, and that gets into what we're going to talk to in just a little bit is kind of narrowing in on what is murrelet breeding habitat. I couldn't tell you what from this 18,000 acres, which portion of that is from the ODF surveys and from Kim Nelson's surveys, and which portion is actually modeled. I'd have to look at the breakdown. So one of the proposal goals was to understand the potential impacts of silviculture treatments on distribution and demography of murrelets in older stands, so greater than 65 years old. And that's where the marble murrelet experiment happened. So the habitat conservation plan sets aside a total of 1,400 acres of occupied murrelet habitat that can be managed under these extensive allocations. It includes a limit of 500 acres of management in the first 10 years of the permit term for a marble murrelet experiment, and with a light selection harvest plan. So 20% by volume, meaning that 80% retention would be happening in these stands. If results show benefits to the species, the additional 900 acres could then be managed, but it's in a two-part. It's divided into two parts to test that 500 acres first. So the proposed study design for the harvest treatment.
Can I just make one other clarification about, can you go back a slide? The 14 acres of, isn't it potentially occupied habitat? Because wasn't the model that Matt did a potential occupation, not, it meant it was suitable for occupation.
Yeah, of suitable habitat.
Okay, yeah, suitable. So I don't know if it's just straight up occupied to Paul's comment earlier. And yeah.
Although there's going to be some, sorry to interrupt, Katie, there's going to be some pre-treatment surveys done, so they may be able to actually narrow in on whether it's occupied or not.
Yeah, that's one of the things I wanted to say, is that we hope to, because if we're going to put an experiment in to determine the effects of the on the marble murrelets, we need to be assured that they're actually there on the 500 acres that are chosen for the experiment. Right. So that piece is an important piece in there. And it's not 20% by volume, it's 20% of initial relative density. And again, that's just the silviculturalist in me having to make sure we're not swapping what the units are. So I just wanted to make sure that was, I don't know if this is what the current plan says, but if so, we need to adjust it. But
yeah, so. I can make a note of that. We'll go back and review that.
And the other thing too, I think that's important. It says 1400 acres of occupied marble murrelet habitat. I'm kind of curious, because I've lost track, to be honest. It was, I think, 3,400 acres. And then of older forests, the greater than 65 that were slated for extensive harvests. And then that, I don't think the math works out, but 900 acres of that, no, yeah, but 900 acres of that were not listed as potential occupied marble millet habitat in any of the criteria, the model or the surveys. And so that comes up to 2,300. I'm still missing some acres and I just don't know where they went. So just something we need to figure out. So does that make sense?
Bob's got them.
Yeah, I was gonna accuse Bob of sneaking them away too.
I think if I'm understanding your question correctly, I think that might go into the buffers that go around some of these treatments, which are not actually being managed or having a harvest, but they're still part of the experiment and that they're providing a buffer around these. I mean, I might not be getting your question correctly, but
no, we'll talk about it later, yeah. But just remind me next time we meet to go through this math with you.
Yeah.
So the design that the group has come up with is this before after control impact design, where pre-treatment data is going to be collected over multiple years, anywhere from 3 to 5 years. And then there will be 25 replicates of 3 experimental treatments. The first is the managed treatment, which you'll see in the red here on that graphic on the right-hand side of your screen. That's where the 80% retention is undertaken. And I do want to mention this is a conservative start. So yes, 80% is quite a bit of retention. And so, but they want to see what as a conservative estimate to start looking at what those impacts are. Then we have our edge treatment where there's an unmanaged stand adjacent to a managed stand. So looking at the impacts of the edge treatment. And then a control, which is an unmanaged stand within 500 meters of a buffer zone. So 25 replicates of 3 experimental treatments. And they're gonna start off slow. This will be done over a period of time, not all starting at the same time. So it's phased in, we're starting at the 500 acres and then scaling up to a total of 1400 if there's no negative impacts observed. So there's been a few questions on how we measure benefits to the species. Normally for most species, nest success is the gold standard of demographic studies. And while nest success will be incorporated into the study design, it can't be the only response variable that we're measuring. First of all, finding murrelet nests is extremely challenging and very expensive. Globally, only 600 nests have been ever identified. And the Oregon Marble Murrelet Project, which worked over the course of 5 breeding seasons, tagging up to, 70, 80 birds on the water and then tracking them in, only identified 37 nests, even with that intensive study. So having such a low ability to find nests really limits the power of our analysis. And it decreases the chances of actually measuring a treatment impact. If we can't find a nest, we can't measure whether or not the treatment had an impact on the murrelets. The other factor is that ocean conditions have been linked to interannual variations in occupancy and breeding. So these are long-lived species and they can elect not to breed when food resources are limited. So they can basically, it makes it really hard to determine, are their murrelets not breeding in the stand because of the treatment, or are they not breeding in the stand because of poor ocean conditions? And just to give you some perspective, over the last decade, so last 10 years, there's only been 2 years where ocean conditions would have actually been qualified as good for murrelets. So what are we going to do? So what we're going to do is be looking at multiple response variables. First of all, monitoring murrelet and predator presence. So we will be doing some of those audiovisual surveys that I talked about before that aren't particularly precise in identifying the nest location, but they are good identifiers for habitat use in general and presence. Then we'll also be doing some bioacoustic monitoring. Now, these are using automated recording devices. And then additionally predator surveys, because part of whether or not the murrelet nest survives is the presence of predators. And there's some information about the impacts of harvest and edge effect on predator density. So they'll be doing some predators stuff as well. The local scale indicators of murrelet habitat, they're going to be surveying the nesting platforms, monitoring the microclimate for moss development, and also understory fruit density, which is a source of food for some of the predators of murrelet nests. At the landscape level, they're going to be looking at habitat suitability, estimating the mean annual occupancy probability. So this is the modeling that we're doing right now. And then also disturbances, looking at just landscape level disturbance patterns. Now, I do want to bring your attention that some of this stuff that we're talking about here is still ongoing as far as developing what is appropriate murrelet habitat and what some of these factors are. This is the information from the Oregon Marble Murrelet Project that's being fed into the Elliott. So there are, this is in the next slide. So Shannon, do you mind? Thank you. Yep, so we're leveraging the Oregon Marble Murrelet Project to develop surrogates for the nest success. So while we will be going out and doing some nest surveys, we have to include other additional data in addition to that nesting data to look at the actual impacts of the treatments on the stands. So one of the things that's feeding in is we're quantifying tree and stand scale predictors of nest site selection. We have a graduate student that is currently using LIDAR, both handheld and aerial, to look at the nest site characteristics and also the stand characteristics of nests that have been identified on the Oregon Marble Murrelet Project, and comparing those to sites that are that theoretically could be murrelet habitat sites, but have not been found to have a nest currently. And he's doing a comparative study. We're also testing some of these underlying assumptions of the survey, the detection surveys, and that's actually almost complete. We're wrapping up that paper as we speak. And then one of the really exciting things is we're using acoustic signals from passive recording units that we've been placing out at nest stands to establish predictors of nesting and nest success. We've been able to detect currently presence of murrelets and stands using these ARUs, but we're still fine tuning these indicators of nesting and nest success. So these are some things that we want to get finished up before this experiment actually initiates, because this is information that's going to inform those proxies for nest success and give us some security in not finding every single nest or managing the impacts of oceans as well. So we can continue the study during poor ocean condition years. Let's see. There is a lot of opportunity for additional murrelet research on the Elliott, and I won't get into a lot of this because it's not applicable to the actual experiment that you received. But just for the purposes of our knowledge, of advancing our knowledge on murrelets and their habitat, we can look at the impacts of in-stand forest management, which is this experiment, the impacts of habitat adjacent forest management, again, this experiment, but we can also be testing new technology. For those of you who, are involved in managing lands that are impacted by murrelets, you know those 2 consecutive years that folks have to be hired in order to go out and do the surveys, and being able to test new technology that could potentially, if you could set ARUs or automated recording devices out and actually get that detection without having boots on the ground. That is a huge potential for a lot of land managers, but also monitoring long-term conditions, so the ocean conditions and other disturbance impacts on habitat. And perhaps most importantly is how we develop future habitat for murrelets and how we manage land in a way, getting rid of a lot of past assumptions, and how do we actually manage land for murrelets in the future. So. I want to take some time to kind of answer any questions you have about, specifically about the experiment that you read. So I'm going to pull that up here.
Yeah, it looked like Paul had a question.
I just had a question about research, and I had someone give me their theory on the researchers visiting nest sites, murrelets, and how that actually would draw in predators. That, you know, and anybody that's spent any time out in the woods knows what crows are like, and they like to follow people to see if there's something in their lunchbox or whatever. So if you're out cruising timber or hunting or visiting a nest site, that actually could be harmful to the murrelets. Is that make believe? Is that real? And if it is real, how do you avoid it?
Yeah, so I wouldn't say it's make believe, because it's certainly a concern, and that's something that we addressed at the beginning. This is speaking back to the Marble Murrelet Project. This is something that we addressed at the beginning of the Marble Murrelet Project. So we take some precautionary measures to try to reduce that, because, like you said, corvids, crows, ravens—they are so smart. I wish my five-year-old was this smart. They learn in just seeing something one time. So they will follow you exactly as you said. So when we go out to a nest site, the first time you're just following a GPS and radio telemetry gear to the particular location. But every time after that, you take from a certain distance away from the nest, you take a new different route in. And there's a kind of a systematic way that you get to the nest through different routes. We use camouflage gear rather than the bright orange gear that you take out hunting. There's a few precautionary things that, and then also there's a certain amount of, there's like no talking within a certain distance of the nest. It's not a perfect strategy. And there is a possibility of corvids following us out regardless of these steps. But we do, every time we go out to the stand, we do predator surveys. So we actually do point counts for predator surveys to actually see if there's an increase in predators over the course of our visits, and if we're actually bringing them in at the same time. So there's some precautionary measures that are taken up front, but also some kind of checks and balances. That said, it might not be perfect, and there might be instances where a corvid happened to be following a researcher out and got a great snack at the end of that. But overall, that, you know, a lot of the, we've, to my knowledge, we've never noted like a depredation of a nest within a very short period of time of us visiting it as well, because we've had cameras running on these nests continually. So we actually know when the nests were, if a corvid actually ate it, we actually know when the nest was depredated. And interestingly enough, of the nests that were monitored via camera, I think there was a fairly limited number that were actually taken by corvids. There were almost equal numbers that were taken by red-tailed hawks, which had never been noted before. So, and they obviously hunted very different manners. So there's still a lot of questions. It is a potential, and it is something that we have in mind. But there are some precautions we can take, and also some ways to kind of test and check that as well.
Thanks for the question. Thanks for the response, Jen. Mm-hmm. Other comments or questions? All right. Shannon, are there other things you were hoping to cover?
I think those were our two main topics that we wanted to make sure to cover today.
Yeah, and noting I don't think we have any public listening in, and I haven't received any comments. Doesn't look like Jenna has as well. We have a new member of the public you may be familiar with, Jeff Huntington, who just raised his hand. Jeff, you have 2 minutes.
Well, thank you very much for that. I want to take five, though. So I want to start out by commenting on this facilitation of this meeting. It really bothered me. But actually, my question, I was just noting that, I mean, both Bob and Mark jumped off the call before the Mayor-elect conversation happened. Has there been any way to give them the benefit of what we all just heard or talked through? Did they have a pre-meeting? Are they going to have some follow-up on this material related to the Mayor-elect experiment?
So Bob is on the technical committee.
Okay.
And so he's been involved in the development of this and has been, we met with him a couple weeks ago to kind of update on some of the changes that were happening in the document. We haven't had the chance to do that with Mark.
Okay. But nothing that was just discussed would be new to Bob. Okay. Thanks. That's the short part of my question. Thank you.
Yeah. And I will say this to all of you and also follow up with the two of them that, you know, I think the presentations are obviously extremely helpful, the conversation and ability to ask questions. There's also the opportunity to provide feedback, you know, written feedback as you pour over the details or, you know, reflect on today's conversations. Please don't hold back in terms of providing suggestions or asking questions. The time is now on these chapters, as well as all of the others that you've been sort of working on and reviewing. All right.
Can I ask a follow-up? You just prompted for me. Hey, Jen, so in the HCP conversations, and I think in the technical group conversations, I had the impression that there was some back and forth about the indicators of success. And I know you had the slide that talked about the gold standard. Is that issue resolved now with the technical team and with the members of the advisory committee that are on that technical team?
Yes, sort of.
The definition of success on that 500?
So acres. Here's the complicated thing, is the definition of success is in development, right? So some of the information that's being pulled from the Oregon Marble Merlot project that goes into what is, we have, you know, occupancy, predator surveys and microclimate and habitat, and all of those things are going into a model of what successful improvement on the habitat is going to be. That model is still being developed. So, and folks agree on the things that need to go into that. The question is still, what timeline they're going to need in order to proof that, and there might be a need to do prior to the start of the major experiment to do some additional nest searching on the Elliott State Forest and compare that with these, kind of basically test this model of what successful merlet habitat looks like on the Elliott. So right now a lot of the information coming in is coming in from the Siuslaw, which has some differences to the Elliott. So they're going to want to test that on the actual Elliott itself. So in that document you'll read, it's built in, there is some time period where they are testing out these indicators and these proxies for direct nest success. And as long as it looks like it's holding up, then we can move forward with that step. There is a consensus that we can't use just nest success. There's a consensus among everybody that we can't use just nest success.
Okay.
Success as a, because it doesn't help on either end.
Okay.
It could over or underestimate. Yeah.
Sorry. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Any other comments or questions? And I just want to flag, Jen, the temporal aspect there, just so folks are tracking that, that it could, there's some additional study and information that's going to come in that could, you know, not delay, but impact the start of the full marbled murrelet experiment by a period of time, but will allow you to have sort of be working under the best available information, so to speak. Good. Any other comments or questions? All right. Keep in touch. Thanks, everybody.